سواء السلام عليكم ورحمة الله، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد، كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما. إن شاء الله today we're going to speak about the interpretation of سورة البروج or the تفسير of سورة البروج. And I'd like to start it with a story which was mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj. And inshallah, after completing the story, we're going to speak about each word, word by word. So here in Surah Al-Buruj, we have this ayah, this verse. Yeah, this one. Kutila ashabu al-ughdud. So my question is, do you know who were the people or the maker of the ditch? Do you know their story? Does anyone know their story? The story of the people who made the ditch? This ditch, by the way, this is real. It's in Yemen, in Najran, in Yemen. In Najran, this is the real ditch that that the Holy Quran mentioned in Surah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj. Depending on Google images, this is the real ditch. This one also, this one. This is the ditch. So do you know any story? Like, do you know anything about it? Okay, so inshallah today we're going to start with such a story, and then we're going to speak about this ayah one by one. This surah verse by verse. So first of all, this is the story of the king and the boy. The king and the boy. One day there was a king. He was Jewish. His name was Zunawes. He was Jewish, as I told you. And this story happened in the southwest of the Arabian Peninsula in Yemen, in Najran. And it happened before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. According to some scholars, it happened 50 years before the birth of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to archaeologists, the archaeologist said that the ditch was 2,000 years ago. So it means about 600 years before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born. To tell you the truth, I believe scholars more than archaeologists, because archaeologists speak about the ditch as a touristic attraction, as a site, so that a lot of people can visit it or would like to visit it. So sometimes some archaeologists go far, like they make things much older than they already are. So let's start with the story. As I told you, there was a king. His name was Zunawes, and this king was Jewish, but he even forgot about the real, the real religion of Jewish people, which is like Allah is the one. And he claimed that he was Allah. He claimed that he was the creator. The king went far to claim that he was the one who created the heaven and earth, who created people and who understood them. So anyway, in order to convince people that he was the Lord or he was Allah, he had a magician. This magician was an old man who had some kind of magic tricks, and he used to know the secrets of people, and then he used to tell the king about such secrets. And then when the king spoke to people and he revealed such secrets, people were amazed and they told the king, "How did you know?" He said, "Because I am your Lord, I am Allah." And he did doing like, he kept doing that for a long time. So one day his magician, the magician of the king, told him, "I'm getting old and I need a boy to teach him such tricks so that when I die, you find someone else to help you." So the king was convinced and he looked for a boy, a young boy. He begged him and he gave him and he told the magician to teach him everything about magic. Yeah, so here we have the story. We have the king who claimed that he was Allah, the creator, the holy maker. And we have the magician, the one who supported the king with his secrets and with his magic tricks. And we have the boy. Yes, honey. Yes, Asma, you have a question, honey? You have a comment? I already started recording.
Please, Sister Hazara, kindly turn off your camera.
So here we have this one, the king, the boy kept going to, kept taking lessons from the magician, until one day on his way, on his way to the magician, he found a hermit. A hermit was a man living alone, worshiping Allah. He was living in his place in, you know, in solitude. I mean, like he was isolated. He didn't interact with anyone. So the boy saw him one time, two times, and then he asked him, "What are you doing?" The boy asked the hermit, the man who was living alone, "What are you doing?" The man replied, "I am worshiping Allah. I'm worshiping my Lord." So the boy exclaimed, "You mean Allah? Like you mean the king? You mean the king which is, who's the Lord?" He said, "No. My Lord is the Lord, is your Lord, and is the Lord of the king. Rabbuk wa Rabbi wa Rabbi al-Malik." You know, he's even the king himself is not the Lord, but Allah is the Lord of your king. So the boy, like let's say that he wasn't that convinced with whatever he heard, but he kept, you know, like going every day to both the magician and the hermit every day. He took lessons from the magician. And he took lessons from this hermit, the man who was worshiping Allah. So one day the boy told the hermit that I was punished because I went to the magician late. So like the magician punished me for going late or for coming late. So the hermit told them, okay, every time you go late to that magician, tell him that it was your family that needed you, so that they kept you with them for a longer time. And when you go home late, tell your family that it was the magician who asked you to stay for a longer time. So times, like days went by and that day, like, you know, in that period, and the boy kept every day, like you see here, the boy had this kind of internal conflict. He didn't know which one was the right one. So he kept taking both lessons, like, you know, lessons concerning magic and lessons concerning Iman and worshiping Allah, the one, and lessons from the magician and lessons from the hermit. And he didn't know how to decide. He didn't know which one is right, which one was right. So one day, on his way again, he saw a very big animal, deb, like a very big animal, let's say a cow or like, you know, let's say like a huge animal on the way. And people didn't know what to do. Like people were afraid. And this animal was blocking the way. So the boy, at that moment, he decided to pray to Allah. He said, "Allahumma, oh Allah, if the hermit was right, help me kill that animal." And he took a stone and he threw it at the animal. So the animal died immediately. So at that moment, and at that moment only, the boy was 100% that the hermit was right. Why? Because he prayed to Allah. He didn't know, like, you know, he was, you know, hesitant. He didn't know which one of them was right. The magician was right in his saying that the king was the Lord, or the hermit was right when he said that the king was just another creature of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he took a stone and he prayed, "Oh Allah, Allahumma in kana Rabb al-Zahid, you know, Rabban, you know, falhimni ala qatl al-Ali, if I just, you know, fasa'idni fi qatl al-Dab, Allahumma, like, you know, in kana Zahid ala haq, Allahumma, if this man, the hermit, was right, help me kill that huge animal." And by throwing a stone at the animal died immediately. So here we have one point. The boy was 100% sure that the hermit was right. When the boy went to the hermit, he told him what happened about the animal and so on. The hermit told the boy, "Now you're better than me. Now you're better than me. You're better than I am. You see, you're better than I am." Okay, so he told him, "You will be tested. Your face will be tested. But if they start to torture you, don't mention my name. Don't tell them about me." Okay, so here we have the boy. He was now, his face even was stronger than that of the hermit. And he knew that the magician was wrong, and he knew that the king was wrong. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the boy special powers. The boy was able to, you know, cure sick people. He was able to return the eyesight to blind people. He was able to, like, you know, to help a lot, to cure a lot of diseases. Till one day, one of the king's helper, like, you know, he was a minister, he was blind. And he heard about that boy, the boy who was able to help all sick people. So he went to the boy and he told him, he brought a lot of gifts. He told him, "Take all my gifts, but help me return, like, you know, help me see again. Help me to be able, like, make me able to see." So here the boy told him, I don't need any of your gifts. I'm not taking any of them. And it is not I who help people, like who help sick people, it's Allah. I pray to Allah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who helped, you know, to cure these sick people. So after that, you know, the minister told him, like, so what do you want me to do? He said that, say that you, like, you know, believe in Allah, and I will pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you. The minister was convinced, and he truly believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And, you know, the boy prayed to Allah to return his eyesight, and he was able to see again. So the following day, the minister, like this man, the king, one of the king's ministers, he went to the king, and suddenly the king saw, like, this man was able to see again. He told them, oh, like, you're able to see. He said, yes. He said that, who cured you? He said, Allah, my Lord. He said, you mean me? You mean that I cured you? He said, no, not you. Like, for sure, not you. Like, it's Allah, the one who created everything. So the man, the king, took this minister, and he kept torturing him till the minister told him about the boy. And then he took the boy and he tortured him till the boy told him about the hermit, the one who told him first about Allah, the one, and about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the king, now we have three people only, three people who believed in Allah in this village, you know, and all other people believed in the king, believed that the king was their Lord. So here we have this one. The king started with the hermit, and he told him, if you don't stop believing in your Lord, and if you don't start believing in me, I will kill you. The hermit refused, and the king already killed him in a very bad way. Like, you know, he cut him into two pieces. You know, he cut him into two. So the ministers saw that, and then he took the ministers and he told them, if you don't stop believing in Allah the One, and if you don't start believing in me, I will kill you in the same way. The minister also refused, and he was also cut into two pieces. And then he came the boy, and the king was smart enough. He knew that if he killed the boy in that way, people, like, he's young. He's not that old. He's not an old man as the hermit or an old man as the minister. He was young. So the boy, like the king, kept talking to the boy to stop believing in Allah the One. Then he couldn't. The boy refused. So the king asked some of his people, supporter, his soldier. He told them, take this boy to on a ship. And while you are in the middle of the sea, like, you know, throw him, like, you know, drop him in the sea. Like, Allah, the boy was confident that Allah would save him. So the boy prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, telling him that, oh, Allah, save me with the way you like, you know, from these men. What happened? Like, you know, those people, all of them fell into the sea except the boy. So the boy was the only one who was alive. Like, you know, all of them died in the sea. All of them drowned in the sea except the boy. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the prayer of the boy. And then the boy went alone to the king. And he went to his palace. He said, like, I'm here. He told them, what are the men? He said that all your men died. All of them died. Then the king asked other soldiers, to take him to every high mountain. He told them, take him to the mountain. Once you reach its top, the summit, like, you know, throw him off the mountain. Again, the boy prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like, to save him. What happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the mountain shake until all men fell off the mountain except the boy. And the boy again returned to the king alone. And the king was surprised, like, what happened to my men? He said that all of them died. All of them fell off the mountain. So the boy told the king, like, you know, if you like to kill me, there is only one way to kill me. So the king asked him, what way? He told him, like, you know, gather all people in a place and then tie me to a tree or a palm tree, and then take my own arrow and then say, in the name of the Lord of this boy, like, let me kill him. Kill the boy. You know, بإسم رب الغلام ورب الغلام. So he told him, first of all, if you like to kill me, there is only one way to kill me. You tried to kill me so many times and it didn't work. So the only way to kill me is just to follow my steps. He told him, okay, what your steps are? He told him, okay, first of all, tie me to a tree, gather all people, then tie me to a tree, and then take my own arrows, and then say, in the name of the Lord of the boy, ورب الغلام, and then, like, you know, kill me. The king did exactly what the boy said, and he already killed him. The boy died. At that time, the boy died. So as you see that the boy was strong enough, he was real faithful. So anyway, the boy died. And once the boy died, everyone believed in the boy's Lord, the Lord of the boy. And the king didn't know what happened, but just you know what happened is there were only three people who believed in Allah the One. And after the boy died in that way, all the people like believed in the Lord of the boy. So one of the supporter of the king told them like, listen, like, no, we made a mistake. Like now everyone believed in like the Lord of the boy. What did the king do? And his supporter, his soldiers, they did this one. They dug a very huge ditch in the shape of rectangular. Some people think it is the real ditch, the real ditch. And by the way, it is, exists till now. One of the scholars said that even he visited it. And as you see here, it's true. Like people go there to visit it. Like ironically speaking, it's ironic. People go there not to learn a lesson. No, people go there to have fun, to watch such things out of fun. So anyway, as they take photos, they feel happy to see such kind of archaeological sites. But they miss the point. The point is why this one was created and what happened in it. Anyway, so they dug such huge ditch and they put a lot of fuel in it, like let's say that wood or trunks or branches and so on, tree branches. And they made a huge fire and they like, you know, put like throw on it everyone who believed in Allah, the One. And it's all the scholars mentioned this story. There was among the people was a lady who was carrying her son, her baby. You know, a lady was carrying her baby. Her baby was just maybe a year old. So she was hesitant. She didn't like to. She was about to change her opinion when she saw the fire and she was afraid for her baby. So once she was that kind of hesitant, her son, her baby, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him speak like Jesus spoke when he was a baby. He told him, "Umma isbiri, oh my mom, be patient, you're right." And like, so she and her baby, both of them were thrown into fire like other people. So this is the story. Yeah, and here we have this story. So it is like some people mentioned, this is the first Holocaust in history. It is not like people now keep crying because of Holocaust, where like, you know, the fires that they were thrown into by Hitler and, you know, by Nazi. And they forgot the first, like, you know, the first Holocaust that they already made, that the King Zona West made. You know, he was Jewish. And even as I told you, usually speaking, when Jesus was sent to people, all people supposed to, like people who were sent them were supposed to turn from being Jewish to be Christian. So this king didn't like to return to be Christian anymore, and like, you know, at all. And he kept being Jewish, and then he forgot what Jewish is or how to be Jewish, and then he said that he was Allah. So this is the story that every almost all scholars mentioned when they started speaking about Surat Al-Buruj. So this is the story of the king and the boy. Here we have, at the beginning of the story, we have وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتُ الْبُرُوجِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودِ. So here we have three, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by three things. Number one, السَّمَاءِ, the sky or heaven. And number two, الْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ, which is the day of judgment. And وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ, you know, I was going to tell you, okay, what both of them. So first of all, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتُ الْبُرُوجِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by the sky many times, like we took وَالسَّمَاءِ وَالطَّارِقِ, you know, we took وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتُ الْبُرُوجِ, and also like in different verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by the sky. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not swear so that people can believe him. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore to indicate two things, the importance of things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by, and what comes after it. Like if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by something, it has to be great. That's why the only person Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We as Muslims, we have to swear only by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We as Muslims shouldn't say wassama. We shouldn't. It's only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the creator. He can swear by anything he created. But we as creatures, we have to swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wassama'i zatil buruj. Wassama means by, this is the swearing letter, by the sky. That as that means which has buruj. Buruj refers to like, you know, the stars, or in some interpretation, constellation. Some people say that four stars that were able to see, such stars are clear to people, because we're not able to see all the stars, and we can't even hear all the stars. We took it last time, wassama' wa tariq. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by saying that people are able to see. So when you look at at the sky at night, you're able to see some constellation, you're able to see a group of stars. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by was samai zat bur, such a sky, as sama dunya, the sky that we, from which we are able, or at which we're able to see some stars. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swear by wal yawm al maw'ud, the promised. Al yawm is the day. And do you know that according to some scholars, they found out that the word al-yawm and the word yawm, like al-yawm and the word yawm, were mentioned 65 times in the Holy Quran, referring to the time of the sky of the year. Some scholars say that, look, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the word day and the day, al-yawm and the word yawman, like 365 times in the Holy Quran. They think that this is some kind of the nice things about the Holy Quran. So here, وَالْيَوْمُ الْمَوْعُودِ, it refers to the day of judgment. The day of judgment. وَشَاهِدُ وَمَشْهُودُ. وَشَاهِد means by the one who witness. The witness, eyewitness, the one who sees. وَمَشْهُودُ, it refers to the thing that is witnessed. So some people kept interpreting وَشَاهِدُ وَمَشْهُودُ in different ways. Some people said وَشَاهِدُ, it refers to like your eyes, your ears, your hands and your heart. Why? Because these organs will witness against you on the day of judgment. Some people say that, but most scholars said that washahid, it refers to the day of Friday. Washahid, it refers to Friday. Washahid, it refers to the day of Friday. Why? Because like they said that angels witness that day, and because this is the best day of the week, and it said that this day is extremely valuable, and there is 1 hour in that day at which you're able to pray, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts prayer at that time. We don't know exactly which hour on Friday. Some people believe that it could be the hour before sunset prayer, before al-Maghrib prayer. But like this day is extremely valuable. And even it was mentioned that on that day will be the day of judgment. وَمَشْهُود, it refers to the day of Arafah. وَمَشْهُود. So وَشَاهِد refers to the day of Friday. And وَمَشْهُود, what is witnessed, it refers to the day of Arafah. It's on Dhul Hijjah. And then قُتِلَ أَصْحَابُ الْأُغْدُودِ. Remember the story. The king and the soldiers, all of them are destroyed and will be destroyed, and they will be burned in the same way they burned faithful. You see? So the maker, قُتِلَ means destroyed or condemned, destroyed or cursed even. قُتِلَ in Arabic means killed, but here it means they were cursed or they were destroyed. Ashab means, like in Arabic, it means friends. But here, ashab, if I said, for example, man sahib al-kitab, it means who has this book, the one who owns it, the owner, the maker here. So ashab al-ughdud, it means the one who made the ditch. So those people who made the ditch and who burned, those people who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are destroyed. This is the answer to swear. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore by the sky and by the day and by Friday and by the day of judgment and by Friday and by the day of Arafat, that those people are destroyed. The people who made this ditch, this great ditch, like in the same the shape of rectangular, this ditch. By the way, this is real. Like when you just, if you think maybe about let's say, according to some, 2,000 years ago, like it was there and it was full of people who were like already burned. So you have this one. So an-nar zat al-waqood izhum alayha qu'ud. So an-nar means fire. An-nar. An-nar means fire. Zat al-waqood, it means when they made this ditch, they filled it with a lot of fuel, which was available at that time. And then they made a fire, not any fire, a huge fire. The same as the fire that people of Ibrahim made in order to burn him when he destroyed their idols. So here we have this one. So an-nar here... So an-nar here refers to the fire that, that was made in order to, kill the people who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Izhum alayha qu'ud. Izhum alayha qu'ud. This one... Hum refers to the king and his supporter. These, the king and his supporter, imagine, they were bloody people. They were extremely merciless. So imagine, they made this fire and they sit next to it, near it, in order to see people while being burnt. So izhum alayya qu'ud. So an-nari zat al-waqood, it refers to the fire that was made into this great ditch. Is hum alayha. Hum, this pronoun refers to the king and his supporters who were enjoying. They were sitting and were enjoying looking at these people while they were on fire. Is hum alayha qu'ud. Qu'ud means they were sitting down. Alayha again refers to the fire. So, النار ذات الوقود إذهم عليها قعود. The fire that filled this ditch and the people who were sitting near it enjoying this one. You know, people now are different than people in the past. I know that, like, if there is a video about people who were killed or burned and so on, by the way, a lot of people watch it. And believe it or not, a lot of people enjoy watching it. But, like, there is a huge difference between seeing a video in which people suffer, and by the way, it is not humane, but just making people suffer and enjoying their suffering. This is inhumane. So imagine they put people into fire and they enjoyed seeing them on fire. So these people were extremely ruthless. They were extremely merciless. وَهُمْ عَلَى مَا يَفْعَلُونَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ شُهُودٌ. So these people who were sitting near the ditch, watching the faithful on fire, like they were like, they were ordered to do that, you know, like to do that with the believer. So watching what they had ordered to be done to the believer. They were watching what they were doing, what the king ordered them to do with the believer. So these people are like, you know, shuhud, they witness what they know what they did. And they know exactly what they did. So they were watching what they were doing and they were enjoying it. So shuhud means witnessing it. Wahum, so this also pronoun refers to the king and his supporter as like they were witnessing what they did with Muslim, not Muslim, sorry, was the faithful, because at that time Islam wasn't even started. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't even born at that time. So these people faithful at that time was Christians, the real Christians, the one who prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who worshipped Allah the one. Before the advent of Islam. وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ إِلَّا أَن يُؤْمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ. So this ayah is really good. Like it means, وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ. It means these people, you know, like the one who were watching the faithful on fire, you know, they didn't find any mistake. I mean, like they didn't find any mistakes in these people who were on fire to kill them or to put them on fire, to like, you know, to burn them. The only reason these believers were put on fire was that they believed in Allah. They weren't criminals. They didn't steal anyone. They didn't, like, you know, fight the king. They didn't say bad words about the king. They didn't, like, murder anyone. The only sin that these people were put in fire for was just they believed in Allah only. This was the only mistake. From the king's point of view, they didn't. So here, وَمَا نَقَمُوا مِنْهُمْ, it means that these people resented only إِلَّا for no reason except that they believed. They only believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Aziz, the Almighty, Al-Qawi, Al-Hamid, the praiseworthy. Means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worth to be described as the Almighty and Al-Hamid, worthy, you know, praiseworthy. So here is this one. So this ayah refers to this huge ditch. People who made it are destroyed, and they, you know, put faithful into this fire and enjoyed watching them burn. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that these people who were on fire didn't do any mistake, didn't make any mistake except believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what will happen to them? So Allah, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. الَّذِي refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Here, these two ayah, بِاللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَمِيدِ, Allah, the Almighty, you know, the praiseworthy. And again, here we have another description, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الَّذِي لَهُ مُلْكُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who owns everything, the kingdom of heavens and earth, the skies, all the skies and all the earth. Like, you know, he owns everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created everything. He created the king. He created his supporters. He created the faithful. He created everything. You know, وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. And here we have Wallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like, you know, is witnessing over everything. وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. There is a verse like, وَمَا مِنْ حَبَّةٍ تَسْكُتُ, you just, you know, وَمَا مِنْ وَرَقَةٍ تَسْكُتُ إِلَّا يَعْلَمْهَا. والله أعلم. It means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything, even if one leaves, a tree leaf fell, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that this tree, like this leaf fell. So imagine it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala witnesses everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees everything. The ones that we can see, the things that we can see, and the things we are not able to see. For example, we can see, like, you know, how the hearts of other people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is able to see even everyone's heart. and everything, all creatures. So just use imagination and think about the creatures, the sea creatures, like that Allah Ta'ala created, all the fish and the whales inside the sea and the ocean. You know, think of the sky and angels, think of jinn and the devil, think of humans, different humans, think of people in different where, like in different places. Like, you know, everyone has a secret, a million secrets, and Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala knows all these secrets. So here, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described himself truly that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who owns everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created the heaven, who created the earth, he created the sky, he created everything, and he witnessed, not only created them and left them alone. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything and witnesses everything. Like, you can never say that Allah created that and here ends the story. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not only created everything, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also witnessed everything he created, every creature. So here we have this one. And then we have the punishment of those people, the people who tortured the faithful, like mu'mineen wal mu'minat, the male faithful, the men and women, you know. And inna, this every time, mostly speaking, every time you say the word inna, it means indeed. Why? Because it's used to emphasize the meaning, to stress that there is important meaning coming. So pay attention. Inna al-lazina. Al-lazina means those. Those. Al-lazina refers to a group of people. Usually speaking, men. Usually. Inna al-lazina. Those people. Fatanu. Fatanu here doesn't have the literal meaning in Arabic. It means torture. Those. Indeed. Those. Tortured. The faithful. Like, you know, believing men. And believing woman, because like a woman, so we have mu'mineen, it refers to male believers, and mu'minat, it refers to the female believers. So indeed, those who tortured the believing men and the believing women, then lam yatubu, they didn't repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They didn't repent. فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمْ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, those people who tortured the believing men and the believing women, then what? If they didn't repent. This verse includes a very magnificent lesson. It means, regardless of your sin, regardless of anyone's sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like more than ready to accept everyone's repentance. So here, this king, like Fir'aun, he said that he was Allah, and he ordered to burn faithful, like believing men and believing women. And despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't close the door of repentance. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened his door, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps opening his door till two things happen, till the day of judgment or till this person dies. Like if when anyone dies, this is day of judgment. Like, you know, when someone dies, this is the day of judgment for this person. You know, because there is no coming back. So here we have this one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as everyone is alive and as long as it is not the day of judgment, it means like we still have a chance to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to ask for his forgiveness and to ask for his, like, you know, for him to ask him to accept our repentance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept, forgive us all and accept our repentance and just, you know, like help us, you know, get nearer to him. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that even these people who committed this huge mistake and he burned a lot of people, you know, they put them in fire, including babies, including children. You see, they killed them in, as I told you, this is the first Holocaust. But despite that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, if they repent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was ready to accept the repentance and to forgive them. You see, so if they did that and even they did not repent, what would happen to them or what will happen to them? They will have huge, severe punishment, which is hell. They will enter hell. And the fire in hell is much, much more painful than the fire of this life, dunya, of this life, like, you know, this worldly life. The fire on hell is not the same as the fire on earth. You see, I mean, like the severity of fire on hell is not the same as this fire on earth. Like, now we can never burn any kind, like, I mean, we can never, you know, stand any of them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from hell. But the point is, these people will interfere. Like, as they do, they will be done. Like, as they did, they will be done. So they burned Muslim, they burned faithful, so they will also burn in hell. So not only this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala emphasized the meaning. He didn't only say, فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمْ. Allah didn't say, فَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ جَهَنَّمُ. Allah said, وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْحَرِيقُ. So not only hill, but also in order to indicate, emphasize this meaning, they will have the punishment of burning fire. Al-Hariq and Jahannam, both of them, like, you know, seemingly are the same. So why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeat it twice? In order to emphasize their severe punishment. They will be punished severely for burning the believing men and believing women. So then what about those people who were burned? What about them? So first of all, some scholars said, once they fell into fire, they were put in fire, they enter paradise. I mean, like they enjoy, like, you know, because they're like a martyr. So martyrs like didn't die. Yeah, they died literally, but I mean, like they enjoy their life. You know, they are in heaven, almost they're in heaven. Even before entering heaven, they were not in fire anymore. So here in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Holy Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارِ ذَلِكَ الْفَوْزُ الْكَبِيرِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the other side spoke about the reward of those people who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here we can say, refer to those people who were burned, like, you know, burned in the ditch. And in general, it refers to everyone who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, inna means indeed. Allazina, it means a group of people or those. Amanu, who believed, those people. So indeed, those who believed. Believed only, not only believed. Wa'amilu salihat. So it means they did good deeds. So as I told you before, intentions are important, extremely important. Actually, they determine the value or the punishment or the reward of any deed. But still, having good intentions alone is not enough. I can never say that I do believe in Allah, but I don't pray. So what is the point? I shouldn't say, yeah, I do believe that we should fast, but I don't fast. So what is the point of believing and fasting then? I should say that, yeah, I do believe in Allah the one, but I don't follow Allah's order. Recording in progress. You see this one? So here we have this one. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّلَحَاتِ. So every time when we read the Holy Quran, mostly speaking, you will see آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا. They believed and they did. لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٌ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارُ. What about them? What about the reward? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them with what? With not only one jannah. Not only one jannah. Jannat. Jannat, it means more than one jannah. More than one paradise. More than one paradise. More than one garden. According to here, more than one garden. What kind of garden? تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتَهَا الْأَنْهَارُ. So below this garden, they have flowing rivers. So imagine, when you look at some kind of natural sites on earth, you find a lot of greenery and, you know, on which you find a lot of running streams and running river. You feel, oh, like it's extremely relaxing and you feel like, you know, it looks really magnificent. So here, imagine those people who believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and who did good deeds. What will happen to them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward them with jannat, a lot of gardens. And these